of the nation's net new jobs and account for almost half of all employment firms. Additionally, they produce more than half of the country's non farm private output. It goes without question that small firms make significant contributions to the U.S. economy. Today's hearing will provide a forum to hear the Federal Reserve's perspective on small businesses' contributions to the economy. This comes at a time when we're seeing mounting challenges in the financial markets. These challenges, stemming mainly from the housing market, may spill over to other sectors of the economy. This will have broad ramifications, including an impact on small businesses. Despite this recent turmoil, small businesses remain a critical source of growth. The number of new businesses measured as the number of created has shown a net increase of over 20,000 since 2004. Just last week, the Labor Department reported nationwide job growth of 166,000 new jobs at a stable rate of unemployment. Small businesses were at the heart of these metrics, and whatever our economic future may hold, we can be assured that small businesses will be the vanguard for production, job creation, and output nationwide. Recently, however, we have witnessed increased volatility in the capital markets. These conditions have been driven primarily by weaknesses in the mortgage sector, but virtually every business sector has been affected by these events. Mortgage market instability has resulted in a tightening of lending standards that has spilled over into the small businesses' credit markets. Indicators reflect that entrepreneurs are experiencing difficulty obtaining credit, and more banks are reporting lower demand for small businesses' loans. I am sure it comes as no surprise to members of this committee that small businesses have more difficulty gaining access to affordable source of credit compared to large businesses or other types of borrowers. Unfortunately, the most recent Federal Reserve report on the availability of credit to small businesses revealed that this continues to be the case. Small businesses continue to rely disproportionately upon more expensive alternatives to traditional credit than larger businesses. Additionally, the percentage of small businesses that use credit cards increased nearly 10% since the last Federal Reserve survey. These results demonstrate the need for strong Small Business Administration programs aimed at providing small firms with access to affordable sources of financing. Yet, despite the obvious importance of small businesses, there remain few studies on their economic role. In addressing the need for solid information on small businesses, few studies have been more influential than the Federal Reserve's report to Congress on the availability of credit to small businesses. Much of the information contained in the report is gained from the Survey of Small Business Finance, which is itself the most comprehensive and up-to-date assessment of small business finance. Over the past decade, this report has provided Congress with invaluable insight into the small business credit markets. Now, more than ever, such insight is a key resource in developing balanced and effective economic policies. With the economic turmoil we have seen recently, it is paramount that we all work together to restore financial market stability and offset the effects of tighter credit conditions. These developments have created uncertainty over our economic future. Our history has proven that as small businesses go, so goes the national economy. In this environment, it is more important than ever that this committee remain committed to ensuring that small businesses have access to the financial tools they need to grow and thrive. I want to thank Governor Mishkin for his testimony and advice, and I commend you to the ranking member, Mr. Shelley, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Madam Chair, for holding this hearing this morning to examine the state of the small business economy. And I think we all want to thank you as well, Governor Mishkin, for taking time out of your very busy schedule to be with us today to share your views on this. faces real challenges. Credit crunch, rising energy costs, and slowing housing market, among others. The October Bureau of Labor and Statistics employment summary and the preliminary estimates of third quarter GDP growth show an economy that is expanding. Job growth in the third quarter was the strongest since the early spring of 2007, with an estimated 166,000 new jobs created just last month in October. The strongest month for job creation since May. October marked 50 months of consecutive job growth. In addition to these positive trends, we have seen wages increase and growth from the gross domestic product remain steady. These numbers surpassed expectations, indicating entrepreneurs and small businesses continue to create new jobs, and the labor market and overall economy remain strong. These numbers provide great insight into the strength of our small business economy. Because of their importance to our overall economic health and well-being statistics, we must continue to be mindful of how the policies we pursue and enact here in Congress will affect small businesses as we move forward. I am concerned over some of the tax policy initiatives that have been coming from the Ways and Means Committee leadership in the last few weeks. As the White House noted, the most recent legislation would dramatically raise taxes on millions of small businesses, stifling their ability to grow and create jobs. Coupling this legislation with runaway government spending, and we are setting up a scenario of public planning on future growth. Small businesses are vital to future economic growth, and I believe that these regressive tax and spending policies put our economic well-being in danger. I am very eager to hear today how the Federal Reserve Board is responding to the credit crunch and the wake of a housing market downturn. I am interested to learn the board's forecast for how the credit crunch is affecting our small businesses now and how further trickle-down from the housing market fallout will affect them in the future. I think I speak for many of my colleagues when I say that we in Congress would like to know how we can help both individual Americans and businesses weather the current credit crunch. I look forward to working with Chairwoman Velazquez and all of our colleagues in this committee to ensure that this Congress does more than just talk about our small businesses and our economic engine, but also acts in accordance with that reality. And the Chairwoman's leadership, this committee has remained cognizant of small firms' proficiency in generating jobs and ability to grow our economy, and we will continue to ensure our small businesses receive their fair share. And just one point, I can't overemphasize how concerned I am about the proposed weather of the world tax bills that's being considered in the Ways and Means Committee. That gives me, I think, a lot of great concern about the impact that they could have on the small business community, because the taxes that the chairman of that particular committee is talking about would fall probably most heavily on small business owners. That's the people that are really targeted by that. And I think we in this committee should do everything within our power to get that less powerful committee to back down to this more powerful committee.
Well, thank you, Mr. Charlotte, but I just would like to add something to that. You know, the matter of the tax cut, it is a long way in front of us. What is more important for us today is the market instability and how that spills to other sectors of our economy and the immediate impact on small businesses. So Frederic Mishkin, it is a pleasure to have you here today. Dr. Mishkin sits on the Federal Reserve Board, Governor, having taken office on September 5th, 2006, before becoming a member of the board. Dr. Mishkin was the Alfred Dwyer Professor of Banking and Financial Institutions at the Rayburn and Chairwoman Professor of Economics at the Columbia University Graduate School of Business. During his career, Dr. Mishkin has also served the Federal Reserve System in several roles, including Executive Vice President and Director of Research at the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, and an associate economist of the Federal Open Market Committee of the Federal Reserve System. Dr. Mishkin is the author of more than 15 books and numerous articles in professional journals and books
to appear on behalf of the Board of Governors to discuss the ongoing threat to small businesses. Small businesses play a critical role in the U.S. economy, and access to credit is essential for their success. As you know, the Board is required to report to the Congress every 5 years on the status of small business access to credit, and our most recent report was submitted on October 26th. While I cannot discuss all the topics covered in our report, I would like to mention a few highlights. I'll then briefly address how the unusual stresses imposed on credit markets in recent months may affect small businesses. So let me turn to the highlights of the 2007 report to Congress. The 2007 report indicates that since our last report in 2002, financing flows to small firms generally increased along with economic activity. Credit conditions during the period were favorable for small firms, and we have no evidence that creditworthy borrowers faced any substantial constraint on their access to credit. Although small businesses obtain credit from a wide range of sources, commercial banks aren't very as in the past with lending provider. Our report shows that among small businesses, relatively large firms and relatively older firms were more likely than smaller and younger firms to use a wide range of types of credit, and were more likely to have their credit applications approved. These results are consistent with the conventional view that smaller and younger firms are riskier, have shorter credit histories, or less liable to pledges security. They're generally harder for lenders to evaluate because they are less transparent. As was true in 2002, the 2007 report emphasized the importance to small businesses of geographic proximity to their sources of credit. The importance of local providers of credit to small businesses underscores the need to preserve competitive banking markets at the local level. Despite the significant consolidation that is occurring in the banking industry, competitive conditions in the nation's local banking markets have remained quite stable. The use of credit scoring in assessing small business credit applications has become common only since the mid-1990s. Evidence suggests that the use of credit scoring increases credit availability to some small businesses. Users of credit scoring models generally report that after their adoption, the riskiness of the small business portfolio either remains about the same or declines, and the quality of the typical credit decision increases. The obstacles to securitize most loans to small businesses remain large. The securitization of small business loans has remained modest and is unlikely to increase substantially in the foreseeable future. Let me turn to small business finances and recent financial market developments. Let me now comment briefly on the possible effects of the recent financial market turmoil on small business access to credit. I emphasize that the possible effects are complex, but we do not yet have much hard evidence, and that is far too early to draw any strong conclusions. That being said, there are good reasons to believe that some evidence to suggest that the recent financial market disruptions not seriously undermine access to credit by small businesses. If the disruptions continue to be resolved in a market manner, will be unlikely to do so in the future. For example, the current turmoil of the subordinated securities backed by non-conforming residential real estate loans and loans of other debts of relatively large firms. Though the securitization of small business loans is still quite modest, we would not expect turmoil in the markets for securitized assets to have a large direct effect on small business lending. Recent events have nonetheless almost surely had some negative effects on small business and access to credit, and we cannot rule out further effects. For example, recent surveys have found the market for small business credit has tightened. These surveys also suggest that at least for now, the effects have generally been quite limited. Perhaps one of the most important concerns with small business access to credit is that many small businesses use real estate assets as collateral. Looking forward, a reduction in the value of their real estate assets has the potential to adversely affect the ability of those small businesses to borrow. Similarly, declines in the value of real estate assets held by banks and other lenders may affect their ability to supply loans, as real estate losses use a capital that would otherwise be used to make new loans. Fortunately, the vast majority of U.S. banks are well capitalized and thus should be able to maintain their lending capacity. Still, the possibility remains that reductions in real estate values and other factors could affect small business access to credit. The Board will be monitoring the economy for signs of possible effects over the next few months. Let me conclude. In conclusion, the health of the U.S. economy becomes an important of the vitality of the small business sector. Our 2007 report indicates that since our 2002 report, small business access to credit has been reduced. Credit conditions have no doubt tightened since mid-August, but small businesses seem generally better to retain access to credit. However, the current level of uncertainty isn't usually high. As the Federal Reserve looked to monitor closely the effects of financial market conditions on small business finances as part of our efforts to ensure that distress in foreign financial markets does not spill over into the broader economy. Thank you. I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Governor Mishkin. So you discussed about the effect of the recent tightening of credit standard from small businesses financing. So my question to you is, to what extent the SBA's lending, Small Business Administration lending and investment programs bridge gaps in private markets for access to financing during periods of tighter credit conditions?
The recognition is that it's actually only a small part of financial finance for small businesses. So I know 5%. So clearly what's really very key is the overall health of the U.S. economy and also the overall health of the financial system to be able to provide the credit to small businesses.
The Federal Reserve makes policy decisions weighing both inflation and economic growth. During the September 18th Federal Open Market Committee meeting, the decline in inflation was expected to be sustained throughout the year, but made it to be watched carefully. The meeting minutes stated that inflation remained a risk due in part to the continued weakness in the dollar. How has the recent slide in the value of the dollar affected your inflationary expectations?
Clearly, when the dollar declines in value, that increases both the price of the points. But actually also increases the demand for exports and therefore prices for exports. In fact, we think of this as just terrible currency and it actually would lead to higher prices in this period. However, the pass-through of the effects of exchange rate depreciation are very much affected by how accurate inflation expectations are. If inflation expectations are well accurate, which is extremely important, and in fact part of what the Federal Reserve needs to achieve and has achieved in recent years, then we find that the impact of the dollar depreciation on the global price level is actually quite limited.
Sir, with a weaker dollar and inflation concerns expressed by the board in meeting minutes, are some inflationary risks being ignored?
It's extremely important to the health of the economy that inflation, in fact, remains contained. Successes of the Federal Reserve System in recent years, and actually also in other central banks throughout the world. Indeed, if you echo inflation expectations and echo inflation, it actually gives you more flexibility to deal with negative shocks to the economy.
We all know that businesses of all sizes must plan and account for inflation. Would you please describe to us your view on the idea of an explicit target, explicit inflation target, and its likely effects on small business ability to make informed decisions?
Well, at this stage, the Federal Reserve has been discussing communication strategies, so I don't want to comment on the issue of an inflation target. What I will say, however,
is that let me ask, can you discuss how inflation target impact the small business sector?
The issue here is rather than thinking so much of an inflation target impacting the small business sector, the way I would think about this is the control of inflation and how that impacts the small business sector. But clearly, having price stability, which is part of our demand, and not only do we care about price stability, but we also care very much about what happens to economic growth and employment. Price stability actually makes it much easier for small businesses to plan and make better investments and therefore do. I come from a small business background, maybe even was in my district, but there was actually a bank factory in Manhattan. Quite extensive amount of country, which of course is not long there. And I worked in my father's plan, and in fact, it's probably the sad rest of my life, which is what has happened to Manhattan. It's on West 14th Street, it's like I'm around to the main school in the district. But really, the years where, in fact, inflation was finally bottom actually created tremendous problems in terms of planning. So I saw this. By having a talk to my father every day at the stable prices, it means that interest rates actually stay low. So part of our so-called new land act is a threat to our congressional rate of the reserve, which, like you said, not only do we want to price stability, a maximum sustainable climate, but also that we should have stable interest rates. Well, in order to get that, you also have to make sure that inflation is under control. That also, we find that when the central banks control the inflation better, it means that you can be much more aggressive when, in fact, there's no interest in the economy. But always, you have to keep your eye on inflation to make sure that you do not end up in a situation which is what we've had in the past, particularly in the 70s, that you actually have the high inflation that actually the economy can help to favor.
It is no secret, sir, that the turbulence we have recently witnessed in the markets grew out of the mortgage market. The Federal Reserve lowered the target federal funds rate above of its last meetings in response to tighten credit conditions that could restrain growth. Housing prices proceed, vacancy rates are rising, and home starts are declining. As a result, several prominent Wall Street funds had unexpected record breakdowns. Given the length of a typical foreclosure process, is it possible that the worst is still to come?
Clearly, the situation in the housing sector is monitoring very closely. The weakness in housing has been a significant drawback of the economy. In the second half of this year, it's only about 1.5% of GDP. So this is a very significant impact. And clearly, the housing market is not only the ones yet, but there's a big overhang of inventory. Houses that buyers have bought and they have not yet sold. And this is actually depressing the effect on the housing market. So, one of the difficult things for a central banker is that you actually have to look at the economy. And unfortunately, we don't have a crystal ball. We're lucky to have a very, very strong staff at the Federal Reserve to help us think about where the economy is going. And particularly monitoring the housing market is, and the housing sector is absolutely one of the key things that we have to do now. We do have to worry about the fact that housing may not do well in the future and when will it turn around.
And isn't it true that financial institutions cannot predict as to the extent of the foreclosure crisis we have on them, since the process could take from 6 months to a year?
And I'm sure they're doing some forecasts of how soon this foreclosure is going to be. It's clear that, in fact, there are going to be a lot of foreclosures down the road. And some of that's already been taken care of in terms of the predictions in terms of the readiness of these financial institutions. This is actually part of the nature of lending. We sometimes do make mistakes. In fact, clearly, in certain instances, we've had a lot of mistakes made in terms of people not being able to pay back loans. And this is something clearly that the financial institutions do have to worry about, and something that we have to be concerned about as well.
Let's take, for example, that in January and July of this year, Chairwoman Nydia M testified before the House of Senate and Banking Committees to report on the conduct of monetary policy. In both hearings, the Chairwoman expressed confidence that weaknesses in the housing market will not spill over in the wider financial markets. Clearly, the perspective was overly optimistic. If the downturn in the housing sector continues throughout the next year, why is that? Do you believe this may have on the broader markets?
Look, one of the things that's happened is that the problems in the mortgage sector have actually spilled over more widely to the financial markets in general. If you think about what financial markets are supposed to do, they're basically solving information problems. They're trying to allow people to take funds and give it to people with good productive investment opportunities. This is particularly important in the small business sector, which is one of the key drivers of the U.S. economy. It's really quite extraordinary how vibrant the small business sector is in this country.
Will this affect commercial lending for our small business
sector? There are clearly a whole set of issues here, but one of the things that happened is that markets are much more complex in their understanding of not only what's going on in the mortgage market, but the very complex products which were related to mortgages. And we've seen survey of CFO officers, however, it is important to note that because the problems in the financial markets have actually been more in the securitization part of the markets, and small businesses typically do not get credit through securitization the way some other sectors have, that the impact seems to have been greater for larger firms rather than for smaller businesses. So there clearly has been an impact that this is why the conditions in terms of the economy is weaker than you might have expected. Is one of the reasons why the Federal Reserve was acting to lower the federal funds rate by 75 basis points in order to try to forestall or counteract the negative effects from this credit tightening.
Thank you, Governor Mishkin. I have one question, and I will come back in the second round of the matter that weighs down. Thank you, Governor Mishkin.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First, I'd like to talk about the credit crunch and credit availability problem that we have. Many of us are concerned that the response to the forecast housing and mortgage crisis has been insufficient in the United Kingdom. Now that communities around the country, many of which is particularly in my state of Ohio, are suffering its effects. Could you discuss what should have been done, what could have been done sooner, and what clearly should be done now?
Understand this plan better, set the procedures up so we don't have some problems that have occurred in terms of loans being back to people who couldn't pay them back. And so we'll see a process of getting the financial markets to work better. Unfortunately, mistakes were made and replaced them with the price of credit at this particular juncture.
Thank you. I anticipate that this credit and lending issues will affect small business. And what is the Federal Reserve doing to reduce the negative impact on small businesses, especially their employees, because that's after a lot of times pays the price when the business suffers.
One of the good things is that going into this situation where we've had this financial market disruption, that the balance sheets of firms has been quite strong. This is true for small businesses as well as large businesses, which actually helps them have the resources to weather this kind of I think that is important here is the nature of small businesses, which actually is pointed out by the opening statement of the chairman of the committee, that they actually have not been able to get access to certain credit vehicles the way other people have, because the information about them is running the gap that typically if a firm is smaller and also it's been around the less time as a younger firm, there's not as much information about it. It's actually harder to get provided to that person and then bundle it together and securitize it. The aspect of that that actually helps small businesses now is that they're not quite as exposed as some of the other sectors in the economy. So, nonetheless, there clearly has been an impact on small businesses because of the tightening of credit conditions. And there has been an impact in this financial disruption on average demand in the economy. In a situation like that, the central bank is supposed to act in order to counteract the negative shocks. Our job is to keep the economy at an even keel, which means prevent inflation from being too high, or actually even preventing it from being too low, but simply also trying to prevent economic fluctuations that are undesirable. So in this context, what the Federal Reserve has done has been to lower interest rates in order to counteract the negative shock that has occurred from the financial disruption. And
good value. It's not going to help the overall economy, but it's certainly will help our small businesses as well.
Okay, thank you. I had mentioned Chairman John Rangel's second November tax bill, so I mean, I don't think statement and voice my concern about it. And it's been said that broadband in Americans ruining small businesses and they pay taxes on their income on their individual tax returns are going to face, in effect, what is it, a triple whammy. First, they'll be hit with a 4% surtax on some of their income. Second, many of them will lose the Section 199 manufacturing deduction that lowers taxes on their business income. And third, this is happening at the same time as large corporations would be getting across the tax cut, making it even tougher for your small business engines of job creation to compete with larger corporations and for those business owners to deal with this increase in taxes. Is that scenario one that should give us concern? Do you have any comments about that?
The Reserve has plenty to do, but we actually don't decide a tax policy. This is exactly what our elected representatives are supposed to focus on. So it's something that I'm not meant to make the decisions on.
Well, as I said, we're on the show. I'm not really concerned about that, and hopefully reasonable minds will come out, but when the time will tell where we're at. And finally, this might again get into an area where you may or may not want to comment, but I'm going to jump into it anyway. Would you agree that permanency in some of the tax code is beneficial to our economy because businesses can then determine what policies they're going to be faced with and how to deal with them on a long-term basis? And in general, do you believe that the tax relief that we passed back in 2001 or 2003 helped the recent growth in our economy? And do you believe that it would make sense to make those tax policies permanent so that small businesses can depend upon those in the future?
I don't want to comment on tax policy, but in general, clearly the less uncertainty we have, the better. And this is clearly beneficial in terms of terms of policy, making sure that people think that the economy is going to rapidly evolve is in fact something that actually helps both directly in terms of launching business decisions, but also just makes people much more comfortable. So, clearly, there's an issue about having less uncertainty, and then the question is, how do you achieve that? And again, on tax policy, I'm going to leave that up to you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Chairman. Okay.
Mr. Sessler.
Thank you, Dr. Chairman. In your testimony, sir, if you don't mind, we very much appreciate all your comments much about business. But in your testimony, you also make very important point, I thought, the most important point, that half of all the jobs that small business. If I could disconnect the small business just for a moment and focus on jobs, because jobs leads to wages. What is your comment about the, if you don't mind just using your expertise, but the study by AEI, Conservative, and Brookings, Liberal, came together and despite all the nice pros that's been presented, and for the very first time, the energy generation promise has not been achieved in America. It took two cohorts in the early 70s, age 35 in some cases. But the time in prime just beginning to say this is where we've been living for lifetime wages. And so what are they doing in the 70s, real terms? AEI with purpose. Jump to 35 years of age, children are coming up, or similar age with children and so on. In real terms today, the next generation for the first time in America is earning less than the parents. Well, how do we address that issue? Lovely jobs. But the median level of their wages has declined in the last 6 years. So jobs are interesting, but the wages apparently is what we really want them for. How do you fix that? How do you address that in a generation of broken promise?
I'm not going to comment on the things themselves. You've always been very
Research on these immigrants, that it's hard to actually decide exactly what the source of these problems are. Some of it is issue of what's the pattern. They have something to do with just the nature of technological change, which is something that central banks and policies of the government may not be able to affect that strongly. And in fact, some of the technological change, of course, can be very beneficial in the long run to the economy. So the problem here is that it's not always the simplest solution to this issue is, but it is an issue. It clearly is not the issue that in fact, in order to have a lot of money to expand from economic growth, that this is not only true from a point of view of issues of equity, but also from a point of view of getting everybody to buy into good policies for the country.
Thank you for having me, because this fits right with those things. It's the jobs for I've never met one of the economists, because they're always sitting on the one hand. My next question comes in when my granddaughters died. If the U.S. President Clinton handed over to President Bush the economy, the Congressional Budget Office said that this would be a 21.5 trillion dollar surplus. What would my granddaughters have done to do that? In 2002, this Congress, Republican majority, decided no longer to do better for them. But should President Clinton and the Republican Congress have come to I understand your comments about uncertainty, but there was a lot of uncertainty in the mountains that you were in. Do you believe that the law, not just tax, but the principle here, that there's some tough decisions to be made as 23 million Americans? If we don't get this tax thing right, we're going to be able to pay more taxes. So, this point of view, should it be like just discretionary? Because you talked about the principles of certainty, so I think this is kind of in your principles of area. This big issue now, because the Federal Reserve Chairman spoke on this in years past, is an important principle to have.
Why do you want to say this? There's different ways to actually try to solve this.
On the one hand, I'm having it on
the other hand, but I don't really have about 2 minutes. I also have to pay for some of this money. I've got to make this up to you.
It's tough to get advice in this day.
Depends on what kind of advice.
Thank you. Mr. Rogers, you know what I went through when I saw the rumors of power. As a small business contributor, the more or less impacted by increasing oil prices compared to the rest of the business world.
I'm not sure what will be more or less impacted because I just don't know the details. It clearly depends on what sector the small business is in. They're very dependent on energy. So, for example, if a small business is one which is providing a service which doesn't use a lot of energy, then the impact would be fairly small. If it's a small business that's very energy intensive, then of course the impact is larger. And I don't have the information to tell you where small businesses. Which sectors they are large businesses, so I can't be sure of this. Clearly, the issue with high oil prices is a very good impact on American businesses in general, because it is a very good increasing the cost of American business. But the good news is that over time, American businesses have become more and more efficient in the country has come into. So the impact on businesses in terms of the higher energy prices. Much you see oil prices going?
Well, I'm not a forecaster of oil prices, but I can tell you the future markets don't see the oil prices going to come in at 4.5 levels.
But
the reality is that we've had the price of oil.
So, there's a lot of uncertainty about the development of the prices. And in fact, it's something that because oil is produced outside the United States, that we don't have a lot of control over. So, I think the answer here is that the best bet is that oil prices will come down from their current levels. But realize there's a huge amount of uncertainty about where oil prices will be.
Which, gentlemen, would you say that they're likely to come down? I would assume what you mean is in the short term. Whereas I think what the gentleman may be asking is in the long term, do we anticipate that they're ultimately probably going to be going up?
This is really hard to say. Well, you have a situation where the fact that there are many countries that are extremely poor have been developing now rather than in this particular time. That's actually increased the demand for the climate targets pretty substantially. So in that context, that does have an impact. But we also need to see these countries actually realizing that they need to conserve about their energy. So we see actually now policies around subsidies, for example, which keep energy prices exceedingly low in some of these countries, for example, increase the demand and make them even lower. So exactly what will happen here is hard to say. The other key issue here is that there's a geopolitical element to this, and a very key geopolitical element. That's really hard to forecast. People are much more better qualified than I do.
There's a bit of a scare factor in the oil price now for the short term, but oil prices may come down a little. For those who believe in the long term, oil prices will come down, probably also believe in the tooth fairy. In 1970, our country went through phenomenon that the world is now going through. We've reached our maximum oil production in 1970, and in spite of 24 oil wells and all the rest of the world put together, we now are producing about half the oil we produced in 1970. There's accumulating evidence that the world has reached its maximum production of oil now. There will be some temporary downturns, but the future is just up the way as far as oil prices are concerned. Is it really think that the Federal Reserve or Congress can do to minimize the negative effects of this for the future of our businesses?
I think that what the Federal Reserve can do is, in fact, to do a job properly. So one thing that's very important, important change in the way the success of monetary policy is that in the 1970s, when oil prices were not up, the view was that the Federal Reserve was not going to do be able to control inflation, and policies were not such that inflation was controlled. And that could have very negative implications for the economy. So, clearly, we don't want to go through that again in the Federal Reserve. But as other central banks now, focuses very much on making sure that inflation is kept under control, and therefore has the benefits that I mentioned, not only in terms of inflation control, but also in terms of the second problem after the rapid stabilization of the economy. What can be done about oil prices? In fact, much of this is just out of control of the Federal Reserve. But then there's issues in terms of the technology, for example, what kind of other energy sources might be able to access, what kind of conservation can be done in terms of minimizing the use of oil prices above the law. There have been positive developments in this regard. As I said, that the use of oil down GDP has actually dropped very, very substantially since the 1970s. And this is one of the reasons why the fear of higher oil prices has been much lessened than it has because of the fact that the economy has been quite resilient in the face of these higher oil prices. So, can more be done? I'm sure more can be done. But the Federal Reserve really, the only thing we can do is to make sure that the higher oil prices don't spill over into higher inflation in the long run. And then also to monitor what the impact of oil prices would be, also on what would happen to the economic activity.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
ranking member Shabbat. Good morning to you, Governor. I'm glad we have this chance to explore the state of small business economy. Small businesses are the engine to our nation's economy, and we must do all that we can to ensure that all the tools are in place to create new and more jobs in this country. As we all know, successful small businesses are beneficial both from a macroeconomic and microeconomic point of view by both increasing the gross national product and personal income. I just want to refer to what our chairwoman has said in her statement about the mortgage market, its instability, and which has resulted in the tightening of lending standards that have spilled over to the small business credit markets. And also add to that what our colleagues have brought up about the rising oil prices, and then talk about tools that could perhaps insulate to a certain degree small business, microfinance, for instance, tries to expand economic opportunities, and community development by providing small loans and other business services to people who have not been able to get help from mainstream banks. Can you tell us today if there's any correlation between the microcredit movement and its impact on the national economy? And if so, what is the economic outlook?
Small business, but very small businesses, and it's something that's actually very helpful. In fact, in places where microfinance has been around longer, for example, in Bangladesh, where it was originally done, so it actually has been able to alleviate a lot of poverty. The issue here again is that having unstable people provide investment opportunities, even if they're poor, is actually very, very beneficial. In fact, I've actually done research on this. It's actually very critical for very poor countries to have their own financial systems. And microfinance is one part of that picture. It's now actually happening in the U.S. to the extent that it can help distressed communities like you. That's a perfect thing. However, that because it's micro and the word micro is in there, then it's actually still going to be a small part of the economy. Not necessarily but important because for these people that it can help, it could be a very big deal. There is the issue that, in general, our financial system is, in fact, very, very long. Microfinance is only going to be a small part of it, even though it can actually target and help a very important sector of our economy.
In your written testimony, you stated that there are many reasons why lending to small business may be riskier and may cause more costly than lending to larger firms. But it's been recently reported that small neighborhood banks have been immune to the credit crisis because their loans are backed by customer deposits and not by complex debt instruments favored by major corporations. It appears what favors small business is their robust local economies. Do you believe that these community banks play a pivotal role in making sure that small businesses can continue to be the engine to our country as we move forward in the 21st century?
Yes, I do. Research on the way financial system works actually talks a lot about this issue that small firms, particularly the smaller they are and the younger they are, the more they're going to be dependent on what we call relationship finance. So that they actually have to somebody who really knows what they do. And particularly in very small businesses, they don't decide the records that the general lenders will have that we can kind of take a look at. You actually have to have a lot of local knowledge. One of the things you can see is that community banks have been a very vibrant part of the banking community. And part of the reason that this occurs is because, number one, they can get their local deposits, but importantly, they have information that the big banks don't have. Because they're actually in the community, they know who is a trustworthy person. And in fact, this is not just better for businesses, but also for households. My wife's family, they're actually, my wife was quite poor, but their parents were always able to get loans from the local community bank. And the reason was that they knew that these people would pay back that no matter what happened. So this idea of, in fact, having this relationship kind of financing is extremely important. And the U.S. actually has this very vibrant community banking sector, which plays a very important role in exactly this regard.
Thank you, gentlemen. Governor, your agency noted expect a significant amount of consolidation in the banking industry. It's taking place, that is the trend. And we discuss how small businesses have this relationship with small bankers. Small banks and small banks are less exposed because these businesses will be able to pay. And so what is the risk of banking consolidation regarding availability of financing for small businesses? But we know that large banks do not do as much small business lending because they do not resort to do so. But when you find is a consolidation of big firms, that if there's less money being done by the larger and other banks coming to the picture, particularly the small banks, will not take up a slide because they can get money from you. So what we find is that the small business sector still has been able to access credit even with bank consolidation.
Thank you for having
me. Yes, thank you very much. I'm sorry about those who have been there with that question. I'm going to make a grand house.
It's the fact that you're there.
Thank you, Madam Chair, for being here and providing me. Before I make my comments, I would like to respond to the gentleman from Pennsylvania's Association of the Anti-Panel Spirit on Republicans. I don't think they were wrong. So I would like to make a comment. I did not say that. Accusing Republicans of being against Pagan. I'm not for Pagan. And I did so with the same spirit I did today. But it's an important principle to uphold that we pay for what we spend. Again, I did so with some reservations because it does not take into account some of the dynamic effects of tax reductions as they lead to increased revenues. But that's the point of the issue there raises the point as to how do we help stimulate small business capital investment. One of the key ways was some of the tax reductions that took a place that were often accelerated or higher levels of Rayburns would tend to point to the issues that we could most quantify most easily in terms of helping small business, whether that's access to capital or education. But I don't think we have as clear of an understanding that our tax policies, such as the one implemented a few years ago, significantly raise and accelerate Rayburn's levels to stimulate investment, which leads to productivity, which leads to jobs, which leads to revenues and helpful things. So I'd like you to comment on that, as well as any other barriers to entry or expansion for small businesses, such as such a critical component of our economy. With planning for the finance economy, so again, I really can't tell you what's a good tax system or not. I rather have experts that do that for a living, focus on exactly that issue. Well, that doesn't help. But I hope to tell you what the problem is. I'm some comment. I don't know if my friends would just say, on the one hand, but it would be helpful to a parent. You're an expert, you're in charge of our financial system. To a parent, some of the barriers to entry and barriers to expansion that we don't commonly talk about. I'll give you one that we commonly raise in this hearing, but it's health insurance. It's health insurance tethers a person to what they're currently doing and increases the cost of risk taking by venturing out into a new hospital or a venture. That's why we do tax policy, I think, is an absolute critical component as well that helps accelerate decisions that might be pushed off to the future to the current parliament. And I think that was some of the dynamic effects that we saw regarding the particular tax reduction that allowed for accelerated write-offs of federal capital purchases earlier in the second year. If I was in charge of tax policy, I'd be very happy to know it to give you my views on this. But what the Federal Reserve can do to help small businesses is to do our job under the mandate that's been given us by Congress. And if we do that well, small businesses simply will prosper. In general, the United States actually has one of the most, I don't know the exact figures, but I think we have one of the most vibrant small business economies. This is actually something that is a very important feature of the way that things work in this country. And it's been an opportunity. It's an opportunity for people actually to grow rich by starting small business. charging. And so on this basis, I really can't tell you exactly what the best way to solve these problems are. I think they are extremely important. And in fact, it's very important that we focus on exactly these issues.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank you, Governor. I'd like to go back to a question that I had to ask about the whole process. One of the statements is that this is quote, your job is to make sure how the process doesn't spill over into higher inflation. Could you expand on how the Federal Reserve makes sure that it doesn't spill over?
So, let me clarify this clearly. Sherwin does spill over into inflation. But it's very important to understand that the Federal Reserve and the Central Bank can't determine what's going to happen to inflation in the very short run when there are shocks, because our policies take a fairly long time to have an impact on the economy, under several years, particularly in terms of inflation. So, what this means is that we actually have to look and ask will this shock to oil prices have a potential effect on inflation further out, and if it does, what are we going to do about it? This is one of the reasons why even though oil price shock may have temporary effects on inflation, you have to make sure that those temporary effects on inflation don't spill over into long-term impacts on inflation. This is why it's so important that the Federal Reserve make it clear that we look at what we need to make sure that inflation in the long run is going to stay stable. It's an incredibly important part of our mandate. The great success of central banks throughout the world, and the Federal Reserve has been a leader in this, has been our focus on price stability. That was not always as true 30 years ago. And in fact, not only did that mean we had higher and variable inflation, which made it very difficult for firms to plan and actually help small businesses in exactly that way, but it actually led to an economy that underperformed in terms of economic activity and in terms of producing jobs. So, in this context, we really do carefully monitor what happens to oil prices. We try to make our best guesses about what might happen in the future, but actually respond to information as it comes in, but always have this long range perspective. And this is why it's very important not to, for example, react to a rise in oil prices, but actually to think about what is the impact in the long run context and then take exactly the steps that will, in fact, create an environment which is one which is successful both in the inflation front and the output front.
I think you would say that part of your job is forecasting.
It's a big part of our job, absolutely.
And that means that we're already in your forecasting pattern in the first half of the year.
We've actually talked about this in the statement that we have made after last week from Sydney, including there's an issue with potentially slower growth in the short term. But in fact, we see moderate growth in the longer term horizon. And of course, having the right monetary policy is part of getting it to happen. The reason why, in fact, we felt the need to lower interest rates by 0.75% was, in fact, to ensure the economy would actually keep growing at a moderate pace. And felt that we could do that and actually not have a negative consequence of inflation, because the natural inflation numbers are coming favorably in recent months. And also that the kind of situation in the overall economy, the balance of supply and demand indicates that we hope that inflation will not rise in the future. But this is something that we have to really keep an eye on. So the difficult problem for central bankers, and maybe we actually need 5 minutes to think about it, but we actually have to really balance these risks. And unfortunately, we don't have a crystal ball. But the Federal Reserve has actually been quite strong in its forecasting operation. One of the great pleasures for me in the Federal Reserve's been very diverse is to interact with our staff and the extraordinary capability of our staff, which has been very strong in terms of thinking about where the economy might be headed. Getting us a perspective, which I think has enabled us to do pretty well in terms of the central policy instruments. So this is part of what makes central banking interesting. There's a lot of science in central banking, but there's also a lot of art as well. So far, we've been doing pretty well, but it's a tough job.
Thank
also being equipped with the main source for them in terms of financing, because they find that there are other sources of financing that are cheaper. So, credit cards do have an important role here. There are firms, particularly sometimes startup firms, you hear stories about them, start out becoming a client and they borrow with a credit card, and many of those cases actually help them to become successful. But clearly, the client's credit card debt is not usually the cheapest way to take for smaller firms. But they actually seek out other services of financing and have been able over the years to be pretty successful getting. And in fact, this sector has been an incredibly important engine of growth in the U.S. economy.
One last question. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the Community Reinvestment Act, the CRA, which doesn't require banks to lend to small business, but it does encourage. Could you talk about that?
That clearly was the case that was resulted in the Community Reinvestment Act. But in fact, banks do worry about the communities that they serve. And in that context, it's not only building households, which is what the act tells them to do, they also actually have an outreach to small business as well. And it's a very important issue in terms of communities. It's not good enough just to lend to households. Wealth generation, wealth creation is frequently coming and typically coming from businesses, and small businesses can play a very important role in these communities. So, our banks actually do, in fact, try to reach out to these communities. And in fact, I think the Community Reinvestment Act, again, to think about this in terms of cash flows, has also helped them to think about this in terms of small businesses as well. And one thing that should be said is that there is an interaction between households and small businesses. In fact, sometimes they say, hey, because, you have a little business, I actually had some stuff in yourself for a while, and I'm actually very good, but I was one point as a corporation. And so there was only one person in the corporation who was me. And so clearly this issue of worrying about households actually means also that you worry about indirectly worrying about small businesses as well.
Governor, thank you. We're on your back.
Thank you. Governor, since 2001, our national debt has increased by $3 trillion. Factors such as tax policy and spending has been responsible for that increase. What impact is there on small businesses when the government has such a large debt?
Several issues here, which is that expands too much, you actually can't actually impact on interest rates. Higher interest rates make it harder to finance investments, and so can impact on small businesses. So again, fiscal sustainability in the long run, having fiscal balance is actually very important. Many dimensions, including one of the areas that's important to you is the potential impact on the cost of financing for small businesses.
In the letter accompanying the most recent survey of small business finances, former Chairman Greenspan encouraged the business owners selected for the survey to participate, knowing that the data collected by past surveys has been critical for policy decisions at the Federal Reserve and in other parts of government. If the survey is discontinued, what alternative source of data information will your agency use to make policy decisions affecting small businesses?
The issue of discontinuance, I think, is an important one. The question is, what's the best way to get information about small business finance? One thing that's very important is that Federal Reserve being a fiduciary organization. In fact, the Congress has insisted that the Federal Reserve run its operations efficiently. And the point of this is, can we get the best information in the best way? The Federal Reserve is taking the view that we can get better by actually getting information by getting it from the small, the survey of consumer finances. And the advantage to that survey is that it's more frequent and actually happens for 3 years rather than five. But as I mentioned, there's this interaction between households and small businesses that's very important. So one of the things that the Federal Reserve has looked at is expanding the survey of consumer finances, both by expanding the number of people that are asked, but also by asking a lot more questions of small business finance. And our view is that in general, that
businesses may well affect the great unemployment. I cannot stress enough how important this survey is for all those members of Congress when we are dealing with decisions, policy decisions. And I guess that we need to look at how we do business here. When it comes to small businesses, quite often they are overlooked, either tax policies or energy policies or any type of tax relief, they become an afterthought. And I don't want for that to happen when you need to have the information in order to make decisions that are important to small businesses. With that, I will recognize Mr. Sherman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just have a couple of questions that I think are two in particular. One, we've had a number of hearings now about how more and more small businesses are engaging in trade and on their profit and bottom lines and their success or lack of success in trading. And we've got a couple of trade agreements before us now, Peru, Panama, South Korea, Colombia, somewhat controversial depending on the country. It's good for us to be trading and then we have to keep terms down and all that sort of thing. But also, issues such as China artificially manipulating their currencies that discuss the things of that nature. And I know I don't want to ask a specific question, it's not a free job, so I've thrown it out there. What can you tell us about trade that could be helpful to us?
I think the passion very firmly in the global economy is actually is absolutely critical to where we're going to be. First of all, it promotes competition. One of the things that makes the American economy so strong is the fact that you have to be competitive. And, this means that you actually have to produce a better product. And when producing a better product, you do better. And indeed, having competitive markets is really the engine of our productivity growth because when you have competition, the global markets means that if somebody's making a product cheap and abroad, then in fact, either you have to get better at finding your product in lower price, or you can find that you're going to be in trouble about being able to. So, the goals that we found is American businesses have been able to perform extremely well. We have an economy, in fact, that has very high employment right now. So, in that context, my view is that trade is something that is an important element in a successful economy. And turning our backs on the global economy would not be very helpful. And would, of course, be very lucky for countries elsewhere as well.
Thank you. And just to follow up on that, those that are more skeptical about argue that, for example, manufacturing jobs and other jobs that have gone overseas, and if there's a net loss of jobs, they would argue. They would also argue, even if we can create more jobs here, they tend to be low-paying jobs and don't have benefits, so flipping networks and rebounds, that type of thing. That's sort of the rhetoric that you hear out there. To the extent that you're able to, could you shed any light on whether those allegations are, for the most part, true or for the most part, not true?
We certainly see that with this increase in globalization, that we have not had a problem producing jobs in this country. So it is true that the people who are hurt because they have lost jobs, because they have a competition with workers abroad, because they have jobs that they're quitting. So the issue, of course, is how do we get some people that maybe get hurt by this? This is something, again, that I think the Congress likes to think about because it is important. But on that, the global economy has been something that has been very helpful to the overall U.S. economy. And conscious of the U.S. are able to actually come up with ideas and actually have the ideas abroad is also helpful to countries elsewhere. So, in terms of employment, certainly, we're in an economy which, in fact, has had employment grow very
still have each year. Some would argue that we still have a few hundred billion dollar deficit each year to some extent, if you will, and we have balance, which was one of the main things. When I came up here in the contract with America, it was one of our main things, balance of budget. It got balanced because of Congress and President Clinton and your parents as well. Together, work together, got it. So I don't know the credit, but it is some of it. As one of the House managers who was involved in the impeachment of the president, I'm sure he'll appreciate this, and I thought it was over there, but I will give some credit for it. Now, unfortunately, since that time, we had September 11th, we had the stock market plunge, we had the bubble burst of the internet stocks, and all of that stuff from the White House, like the war in Afghanistan, and Iraq, and we had additional expenditures, et cetera, et cetera. So, deficit shot back up, and it seems to be coming down again, although as fast as a lot of us would like it to. But what I'm doing now, you'll hear people say, well, the deficit, even though it's X amount, if you look at it in terms of the overall GDP as a percentage, it's not as high as it was earlier, and therefore it's not really as big a deal. I didn't say that, but I'm saying that that's what's on the market. And the impact that all that has on the economy and job growth in the future. Could you comment on that?
Again, I think this issue of fiscal sustainability is very important. In fact, for years, it's not just what the deficit is now, it's the bottom line. Fiscal sustainability is very key. In fact, it's not just the current spending versus saving versus revenue, but also what kind of obligations that we have in the future. For example, Social Security and Medicare. And this is something that I think something that should be a major concern with Congress. But then how to actually deal with this and get fiscal sustainability to happen. That's why you don't pay the big bucks.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to go back to the chair. Ms. Evans-Jones.
Thank you very much. And thank you for my practice to my colleagues and to witness with you today. We always have two or three things, and it's so time back, and I appreciate your patience. And I don't know if you've covered this, and then I'll just move on to the next person that don't cover the Community Reinvestment Act. You got, I know that you got that in your testimony.
It was a question from Mr. Davis.
Well, the question goes really to just how active the banks like to pay. We can write to us in September and San Antonio, you know, we have to have banks, and in essence, the community banks have to be here anymore, and of course, Rogers and subject events. Is there any intention to be paid in CRI obligations in banks? Because we know when they comply that small business men and women definitely benefit. And I don't know if Mr. Davis basically asked the same question, you already answered it, and I can move on.
Okay. Certainly, if it complies with the Community Reinvestment Act, it's something that the Federal Reserve should place back. Supposed to be doing in this community. And so part of our supervisory process is to look at banks in this regard and to ensure that they are complying with the act.
And with the merger, so if you have fewer players, then how does that impact the benefit?
I think that the fewer players doesn't change the effort to comply.
I don't know if I understand that, but you can listen to that. Do you have any report that's forthcoming, any recent studies? I know that Mr. Department of Financial Services was thinking of having a hearing on it. I'm not sure if that's transpired, Manager. Are you more aware of that? I'm just wondering if you're going to do anything like
that. I'm not sure, but if we are doing something like this, I'll be more than happy to get back to
you. If you were, I would really appreciate that. Free trade agreements, because this came up the other day when we had the ambassador. Why is it important to include environmental and labor provisions in there as far as compliance and regulatory scheme that we will make sure is imposed by our credit partners?
Well, again, I really want to be coming with the instruments of the trade agreements. I have expressed that I am somebody who believes that
emphasize that they're important in a positive influence on others elsewhere in the world. Very important in the rest of the world. In fact, benefit by global economy. In fact, one of the great things back in history is that the U.S. actually encouraged this global economic system after World War II. Now, I understand the international professions and good policy and need to be advanced and so on, but the point I'm always trying to make from a business perspective is we need a level playing field for all of our domestic land. This is competitive winner. So if we have a regulatory scheme that actually imposes greater cost in the product or service that we actually provide, and we don't, it's a tremendous disadvantage. A lot of people say, well, you just supply to the environment because you're a tree holder. Or you're into labor because you're into labor. Well, you know, you may be, but the other reasons are very practical, very important, and I'm afraid that we just have never really emphasized that part of it. The last question I have is just the cost of energy and the potential economic impact. We're going to have an environmental bill that hasn't translated yet to the point that it's going to run this thing by Christmas, if not sooner. But look at the small business impact. I mean, they're on the margins on another carrying doing it. They don't absorb, they don't really get pass on as easily as I think some of the big markets are not evaluating the rising cost of energy. They're not just talking about, you know, gasoline, but you know, natural gas and such. I mean, this is going to be huge this winter.
What's happening with oil prices to gasoline prices? What impact is it having on natural gas prices? This prices actually do have an important impact on the economy. In fact, it's something that we have to monitor and have to think about what's going to happen in the future. We talked about the lack of active forecast and active policy. And thinking about what the role of energy prices and the higher energy prices are going to use the as an economy, as a factor.
Yes, my concern is the disparate impact that it has on small businesses. They're just too close to that. As I was saying, operating on the margins. So when their operating costs go up, and it's really big, is the I'm not sure if the Fed looks at the very distinct position that small businesses have as opposed to the overall economic picture. And we can't say, gee, they're the economic engine in the United States and such. But the truth is that we probably don't really look specifically as to what kind of relief are we going to try to provide them to confront and as they survive. Okay, I don't think they survive very long. But again, thank you for your testimony and you look back.
Governor, thank you so very much for your contribution this morning. The members will have 5 legislative days to submit statements for the record without objection this morning.